Hi, everyone. Welcome to CUPE Connect's third webisode, From Ally to Accomplice, Becoming an Anti-Racist Activist. I'm Dawn Bellrose, CUPE Ontario, Indigenous representative. My pronouns are she and her. I'm also the Human Rights Chair and a member of Thessalon First Nation. I'm grateful to be coming today from the Anishinaabeg territory, and thanks to the Anishinaabe people who have been stewards of this land. I'm very happy to be a part of this important discussion alongside Kimalee, Phillip, the CUPE Ontario Human Rights Representative, as today's monitor. Conversations about being in solidarity with people facing systemic racism and discrimination are always necessary, but today there are more than ever. We're in the middle of a crisis that is disproportionately impacting racialized people, women, people with disabilities, Indigenous communities, the LGBTQ+ community, migrant workers, and many more. It's exposing the deep inequalities that have taken root for so long. That's why I'm honored to be joined today by Sarah Jama, a community organizer from Hamilton and the co-founder of the Disability Justice Network of Ontario, an organization committed to building the political and community power of people with disabilities. She currently works at the Hamilton Center Civic for Inclusive as a senior program coordinator. Welcome, Sarah. And Michael Freeman, a national equity representative for persons with disability. He is Tuscarora Eel Clan from Six Nations, who has worked as an elementary teacher at Six Nation Federal Schools for 27 years before becoming an education policy writer and developer. Welcome, Michael. And our very own Susan Gapka, a founder and chair of the Trans Lobby Group, a member of CUPE Ontario Pink Triangle Committee and the CUPE Ontario Women's Committee, and the CUPE Ontario Executive Board. Susan works at the 519 since 2015 in the Education Department as an Education and Training Facilitator. Welcome, everybody. Thank you all, and now I'll pass it on to Kimalee.
Thank you, Dawn. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. As Dawn said, my name is Kimalee Phillip, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. I am joining everyone from Toronto. Toronto is in the dish with One Spoon Territory, which is a treaty between the Anishinaabe, Mississaugas, and Haudenosaunee. And this land is home and has been governed and cared for by so many Indigenous nations up until today. And so I'm really grateful and honored to be on this land and to be in conversation with all of you. I also want to say thank you so much to everyone who has submitted questions and comments. Some questions and comments are ones that unfortunately we cannot address during today's webisode, but will be best dealt with if you were to reach out to your local executive and or your staff representative. For example, there were comments around accessing sick days and pension plans. So I want to encourage folks who are listening in, if those are the kinds of questions you're sitting with, to please contact your local executives. And I also just want to say that there were others who acknowledged that they wanted to join us live, but unfortunately they could not do so. And I want you all to know that the webisode will be recorded, as all of the webisodes prior, and they will be available on the CUPE Ontario website. So that's cupe.on.ca. And also on CUPE Ontario's Facebook page. The links that will eventually be put onto the CUPE Ontario website will have French subtitles. So do know that if you are unable to join us live tonight, the recordings will be available to you. And I also just wanna give a special shout out to someone called Annette, who actually submitted in advance of this webisode an offering. Annette wanted to perform a poem during tonight's webisode, and I just wanna thank Annette for that. Unfortunately, we were unable to take you up on that really kind offer, but if you are on the call, Annette, if you're joining with us, please drop your name in the chat and let others know how they can contact you, because Annette is a performer, a poet. So thank you so much again, Annette. There were also questions around what is CUPE National doing to support the Black Lives Matters movement, and in general, the movement for Black lives. and questions around timelines that CUPE is adhering to when it comes to addressing racism and inequalities. There were so many amazing questions. We're hoping that we will get to them once the panelists have shared their insights and wisdom. And if we aren't able to, please stay in touch with us and we will try to answer them at a later date. So again, thank you everyone, participants and panelists. So we'll just jump straight in. And what I'll do is I'll call on folks, I'll invite you into our pretend circle, our virtual circle to share. And the first question I wanted to hear from you, given the title of tonight's webisode, is what do you understand to be an accomplice? And why do you think it's important to move from being an ally to an accomplice? So I'm wondering if we can start with Sarah.
Hi, thank you for having me. I'm super excited to be here. I think the ways that I think about an accomplice and an ally, I'm not an expert, but I kind of think of it like this. An ally in today's day and age, in the Justin Trudeau era, is somebody who will parachute in. A parachuter, somebody who shows up when the timing is right, to be a part of something, to be a part of change making in the most vain way possible, right? To just stand there when the work is already being done for the pictures. An ally is also somebody who's often fueled by white guilt, with no real understanding of systemic oppression in a way that links oppression to common themes of capitalism and racism and homophobia and sexism and ableism. And a lot of the issues that people are fighting against day to day that are connected, that are not separate. I think an ally is someone who's super performative, whereas an accomplice is the exact opposite of that. It's somebody who is not just there in the moment, but somebody who actually takes on work, somebody who's not there to feel good and instead understands that in order to actually make change and move toward a just world, we have to work together. And I think a prime example of what an ally is versus an accomplice is when Justin Trudeau himself was pictured protesting at Climate Strike Canada's, or Fridays for Futures, I think it was a protest, and there was a picture of him marching with a bunch of youth. And he himself is the prime minister of this country and has failed again and again to uphold Indigenous rights, to uphold his promises around climate change. And he is the same person who will go and march, yet put money toward pipelines. And so that is a liberal example of an ally who is more concerned with performativity and upholding this neoliberal idea of what it means to be an activist than they are with actually making change.
Thank you, Sarah. Susan, do you want to build on that and tell us what your thoughts are? You're muted, Susan.
I'm not on mute anymore. There we go. That's why the screen didn't change. So I'm Susan. I use she and her pronouns. Should have put that in my bio. En français, elle. And just got to say, as a white settler background, Canadian citizen, learning is really, really hard. That's going to be my sort of, and how do I best learn? I learn with gentle teachers. The people on the screen here and some of you in the audience, those of you have given me some tougher lessons and some more gentle lessons, but it's taken a while for me to feel comfortable to say that I have white privilege. I have an education. I'm able to access certain services as my I'm able to access certain services due to my citizenship as Canadian, and I don't experience barriers. I've experienced some barriers, but different types of barriers. The framework that I like to use and I want to introduce was one of intersectionality, and I have a series of notes, but all on a multi-purpose design here, but let me bring it up. But to use that intersectionality framework, first used by Black feminist scholar Kimberly Crenshaw in 1989, And intersectionality takes views of race, categories, class, gender, sexuality, nation, ability, and age. And it takes into account the full range of identities in historical, social, and political contexts, as well as unique individual experiences and circumstances which mutually shape each other. I find this works really well for me because in the labor movement, we see an injury as one as an injury to all. And being part of the Pink Triangle Committee, which addresses two-spirit, gay, lesbian, LGBT, and plus identities, that we see that as being, those are multiple approaches. And for example, a gay Black man may face racism in the LGBT community and homophobia in the Black community. The other framework that helps me understand about allyship and becoming an accomplice, and for me, that's an action verb. Moving from allyship to being an accomplice requires some action. Do some of the heavy lifting and taking a leadership role in supporting members of disadvantaged communities. Also using an anti-oppression lens. And oppression is relations that divide people into dominant or superior groups and subordinate or make other groups inferior. An anti-oppression challenges that inequality and disadvantage, and the lens strives to challenge all forms of oppression, including racism, sexism, homophobia, I'll add transphobia and cisgenderism. And so on that, that's really important for me. It fits into the liberation model that comes out of the 1960s and 70s in my experience, 1960s and 70s, and the different experiences that we've had. And the other one was around two-spirit health and reconciliation. And so I'm just going to go to part of the UN Declaration on Indigenous Rights that says Indigenous individuals have equal right to the enjoyment of the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health, and states that we should take all necessary steps with a view to achieving progressively the full realization of this right. So thinking about it in that particular type of framework helps me understand how not only to become a better ally, but to be an accomplice and to work together with each other. I don't know where I'm at on time, but I'll turn it over to Kimberly now, and we'll move to the next section.
Thank you, Susan. And Michael, can you tell us your thoughts on how you understand the term accomplice and why you think it is important, or maybe it's not important, to move from being an ally to an accomplice?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for inviting me as well. And I just wanted to say that, you know, these thoughts are my own. I'm not representing anybody here. I'm not trying to put that front forward. But, you know, when I started thinking about this concept of ally to accomplice, I was confused by it, quite honestly, because the term accomplice to me means something negative and derogatory. And you look at it as a criminal thing. And so I'm not going to challenge the language that we're using tonight, but the intention is, who is that person, the next level above an ally? And, you know, an ally is that person that, you know, that comes in, you know, they're not really putting themselves out, and they're going to help you out in some way, or they're going to ask you a question that might give them a little bit of information. And that person, you know, they're on the beginning trail of trying to understand. To me, racism, bigotry, all of that kind of stuff is born out of ignorance and fear. And for people to try and say, can you help me understand something? Can you help me be a part of your world in this way? Then that's their first step in saying, I don't understand everything, and I really need to learn from you so that I can be better at who I am. So when we move from the accomplice, from the ally to the accomplice, I think that's moving from the ally to the activist, or showing into activism. And I don't want to get into the illegal type stuff, but that person is now going to put them into some kind of a harm's way, potentially. And look back when the, and forgive me, names escape me all the time, but when there was the struggle a few years ago on one of the reserves in the States where they wanted to put the pipeline through and underneath this river, and you know, there was people from all around that came and said, don't do that, you know, this is their land, you know, Aboriginal people have such a small amount of the original territory, and yet you're putting it through their land instead of the center of town. And they were peaceful protesting that. But then somebody brings in a water cannon and they almost blow the arm off of that one lady. She wasn't Aboriginal to my knowledge, and she came and inserted herself as an ally, as an accomplice, trying to further the movement of protection. And yet the violence was accepted. Somebody from that protest just got out of jail. They were in jail for 4 years. And yet the people that were manning that water cannon didn't end up having a charge at all. And where's the justice in that? There isn't any justice there. So, you know, I look in my life for a lot of allies, and that's where most people that I meet are going to stay. That's where they want to be. That's where they're comfortable with. And I accept that. It's not up to me to try and force them out of their comfort zone. But I love it when people say, how can I help and what role can I play? And you tell me, you help me understand what you need. And I will see if I can join you in that role. So for now, that's what I have to think about that.
Thank you, Michael. Yeah, it sounds like all of you have brought up really important points. And I think, Sarah, you were speaking to the need to move from doing something because you hope you'll be commended, right? Doing something because you're waiting for the thank you, and actually not doing things in a way where you're just performing. You're not really doing things because it's grounded in liberation, it's grounded in risks. And I think, Michael, some of what you just brought up is around like being an accomplice is like actually taking risks, like actually taking chances and moving out of that place of discomfort. Not because you are, again, waiting on someone to see what you've done and to give you a pat on the back, but because you know that this is what is needed in this broader fight. And Susan, I think one of the things you brought in was getting us to really remember that even though this webisode is about anti-racism work, that anti-racism work is so deeply interconnected and dependent on other forms of domination and discrimination. And so remembering the multifaceted parts of our lives. And so I wanted to actually just hear from all of you, now that you've heard each other respond to that question, do you wanna say something? Do you wanna respond? Do you wanna add something to what you heard your fellow panelists say?
I think that when we talk about the idea of some accomplices, maybe that word kind of being derogatory, and sort of this idea that sometimes things can be messy and sometimes illegal in order to make change. I think actual proper accomplices who take risks know that things actually have to not toe a clear legal line. Most of the times when things are super disruptive, it's only possible because accomplices, oftentimes particularly white accomplices who understand the risk that they're taking on in these spaces, will be the ones to put their, should be the ones to put their bodies on the lines to do some of the more disruptive actions to make change. So I'm thinking about, things around, I don't know more, what's going on with land back lane right now. The importance of making sure that at all times, to be a true accomplice, you must be somebody who's willing to take those risks. Because the people who are always going to face the burden of the justice system and the incarceration system for pushing for what's right will be people of color, Black people, Indigenous people who've been pushing to see the change implemented. And I also think there's a lot of conversations going on around, you know, my organization is, you know, anti-racist, or I'm an ally online, or I'm going to put up a black square to show solidarity with what's going on with the mass global movement that we're in the middle of. And I think that people often talk about defunding the police and things that they think sound supportive without really totally being in line with the cause itself. So you'll hear a lot of conversations, for example, about, hey, we should defund the police because more money should be going into services. Well, yes, but also we should defund the police because policing is inherently a violent and corrupt system that was built upon the bodies of Indigenous and Black people in this country, not just in the States. So to only talk about the corner of the issue that you feel comfortable with, and I've seen that happen a lot, the little piece of the issue which people feel comfortable with, which is taking money away from police and putting it into services, that's allyship. That's not accomplice. That's not being an accomplice. That's not showing me that you actually understand what we're fighting for, what the root of the issue is, and what is going to amount to change. And it's not just about taking a little bit of money, putting it into mental health or other services that allies deem, you know, more useful in the community. It's actually about talking about defunding, dismantling, disarming, and abolishing police, right? And oftentimes it's the allies, the self-proclaimed allies, the parachuters, who will stop the conversations over and over again from getting to that point. And I'm not saying that point will be reached immediately. People have been working on abolition for years, longer than I've been born on this planet. But it's often allies who will hinder the conversation before, you know, people of color and Indigenous people and Black people can even move it to the point that we're trying to get at. So when we're talking about allyship versus being an accomplice, remember that you're part of something bigger, that when you're speaking to issues publicly, that it's not just about your opinion, you're influencing and contributing to people's perception of a movement that includes CUPE, that includes other unions, that includes individuals, right? If you're gonna talk about an issue and you're not gonna go to the root of the problem and talk about like the issues with policing, then you're not really doing anything useful.
Thank you, Sarah. Michael, Susan, did you wanna jump in? Maybe you've heard something said in the earlier round or even now you want to respond to or add on to?
Sure. Well, my brain is going off in two different directions because I'm thinking about Michael and Sarah here on the line and Don, we're all, and Kimalee, we're all from different, by looking at each other, we see we're coming from different communities, but we all bring that intersectionality. And there's some allyship in that, there's some support. So I should be ready to do anti-racism work or workers with disability to help make space for Indigenous issues. And then Sarah went off. And so I'm thinking about that and how like that should be part of my action and part of my work. But then Sarah started talking about Black Lives Matter, and that got me thinking of a whole bunch of other things. Now, I had hoped for, you know, pharmacare, universal pharmacare, maybe dental care down south, maybe Medicare for all, basic income of some sort of income security. And here we get a movement on the streets during a pandemic that is bringing forward a dismantling of the colonization justice system that's created. And just as you said, Sarah, and you gave me something to think about, was it's more than just taking the money. People see it as an economic moving money from, I'm thinking of a game, moving it from one square to another. But it's about really pretty cool because we really need to dismantle the entire system. Can we do that in my lifetime? Probably not. But you've got me thinking about that. And I think that's a pretty powerful movement. And I can mention that CUPE Ontario is working on that. We passed a resolution in June, a very strident resolution. It's in harmony with the Ontario Federation of Labor resolution, and in the next couple of weeks we're going to be having a strategic planning session and we're going to talk about moving forward on an action plan on that. So it'll be a pretty vibrant discussion, I'm sure of that, but you know, that'll be my opportunity to move from being an ally an accomplice.
Thank you, Susan.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of things, as Susan says, embroiling my mind right now about where we can take this conversation. Somebody mentioned 1492, Take Back the Land Lane, and you know, what is the foundation of that? And one of the issues is, you know, the OPP goes in there and they serve these injunctions and then they slap handcuffs on people. But what in its basis, they're saying that their system of justice is paramount, and it supersedes any other system of justice. What they fail to realize is that in the beginning, the Haudenosaunee people fought on the side of the British as allies. So when this land up here was given to the Haudenosaunee and we moved out of the Finger Lake area, well, we were moving as allies. We were coming into this territory as allies of the Crown, not as subjects of the Crown. So they're treating us like subjects of the Crown, and they're imposing their laws and their justice system, which is unjust, by the way. So, you know, they're imposing their system instead of talking to each other about each other's position and where each other's foundation is. So they're not seeing those individuals that are there, the land defenders. They're seeing them as occupiers, not defenders. They're seeing them as invasionists, not as people that are trying to take back what is already theirs. One of the key pieces of things that should be known about that particular situation is when that plot of land was bought many years ago, you know, 150 years ago, where did the money go to? The money went to the federal government. The federal government has that money, not Six Nations. So Six Nations never gave up that land. So why is it assumed that it's others to take right now? Because, you know, it's not theirs. So there's an awful lot for us to learn about each other's positions. There's an awful lot that I don't understand about what Susan's talking about and what Sarah's talking about. It doesn't mean that I can't walk beside them as we're trying to come to some kind of resolution, but I'm gonna have to take some time to come up to speed on those. You know, the concept of defunding the police, you know, I have my thoughts on that. And the decolonization aspect of that, yeah. The takeaway of the militaristic style weaponry, yeah. The takeaway of all the militaristic style training and whatnot, the mentality and the thinking, all that has to go, you know. So there's an awful lot for us to do. But to defund the police 100%, we'd have to have a conversation about that, because I'd have to understand where we're headed before I could say that I agree with that. So, you know, we're challenging each other on so many different levels just from this one question. We haven't even gotten deep into this yet, and we're you know, having these brain cells pop in so many different directions. And you know, I appreciate the passion with which Susan and Sarah are talking, and I'm envious because I love their passion, and I wish that I had that too.
You have it, Michael. You have it. Yeah. And I think what you all have shared is like you're really inviting us, compelling us to question what it is that we have been told are the containers within which we move and operate in this world. Like, we are told that this is what is considered legal and everything else is not. And we see the ways in which legality shifts depending on who's in power and who has the power to make these decisions. So I think this is really interesting, and I wanted us to move to another question I had put aside for you all, but I think let's just move into the questions from the audience members, because it's already 7. We have about 15 minutes, maybe 30 if we can make it. So let's look at what some of the audience members are asking us. There's a question from someone. The question is, do you have any strategies for helping allies understand the complexity of intersectional identities? The person says, I find often I am met with many good intentions, but I'm struggling with how to direct people to also acknowledge and appreciate that people cannot as easily separate parts of their identity when they belong to more than one equity-seeking group. So for example, someone who is racialized, but someone who is also 2S LGBTQ+. So how do you have any suggestions? Maybe we'll hear from one person, or if all of you want to comment on that. This person is seeking advice around strategies for getting people to understand that we are complex beings and we don't choose and sift which parts of ourselves we show up in a room with.
I think that the problem with like modern, like everyday understanding of intersectionality is like most conversations, like it tends to get stuck into this capitalist way of talking about things on an individual level, about each individual people and persons. But I think when Kimberly Crenshaw, and I'm not an academic, this is just what I picked up from looking into it, but what she meant when she came up with that theory was to give us the language to critique how systems interact with us, not how we're read by systems and other people. And so when we're talking about intersectionality, how do my identities impact the ways I am harmed by the medical industrial complex, the prison industrial complex? How do my identities as a Somali first generation disabled Black woman, cis woman, intersect in ways that continue to push me out and harm me because of the systems that were built to do such things to me, not because I am disabled or I am a Black woman, right? It's this world around us that needs to be analyzed with these lenses of intersectionality. So it's less about how I individually show up into a space or when I'm with my friends or when I'm in an organizing space, and more so how society has taught each one of us systemically to like read people who have these different identities and for what purpose. It always goes back to what purpose. What purpose does it serve the systems that continue to harm us to say that Black women are too loud, that disabled people are too stupid, and all these things that were fed from childhood, right? It seeks to build a society and reinforce this idea that we are less than, because if we are seen as less than in every single space that we enter, our morale will be so low that we can never move toward making change. And so I think when, especially as activists or as people trying to become allies and accomplices, trying to have these conversations, do not revert as much as possible into this capitalist idea that we have to talk about each individual piece of our trauma every time we enter into this space. You can experience trauma, and you do experience traumas on these intersections, and you can still do the work. So you don't have to divulge each and everything based on your identity to do work in these spaces. But oftentimes, capitalism has taught us to be so individualistic in how we talk about these things that we tend to just make it about ourselves. Does this make sense?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, thank you. Susan or Michael, did you want to comment on that question?
Yeah, one of the things that I find is that that concept of intersectionality, people don't want to know people on a deeper level. You know, when I go into a room like a convention or a conference and we sit down and we're supposed to meet each other, they say, you know, what's your name? Where are you from? And who do you work for? How uninteresting is that? That's very superficial. We don't want to know each other on any other level except for those very quick little sound bites, those labels, those boxes that we can stuff people into. I'd much rather ask Kimalee or Susan or Sarah, which book did you read last? What did you find that was enjoyable about it? And what was the last thing that made you laugh? That's going to tell me a lot more about who you are than any thing about, you know, your name, your location, and your job. I'd personally prefer to know all of those deeper things. I was on a panel for the UNE, and the person on my right, her name was Haley. I said, this is my friend Haley. I said, I didn't have to introduce her as my Black friend Haley. That's unimportant to me. And I don't mean it's insignificant. I just, we're friends. So we're friends, whether she's Black, white, Chinese, or any other, cultural origin. And so the person on my left was similar. I define them by who they are and how they make me feel and the work that we do together and how I connect to them. But we don't connect to people that deeply. So then we start looking at those boxes that they fit into. For me, people, when I was growing up, I went to school on reserve. I was too white to be Indian. And when I went to high school, I was too Indian to be white. So people put me in a box because of how they were thinking about me. What they think of me is none of my business, but I want them to know me. And once they get to know me, then they'll start treating me as a person, as an equal, as a human, you know, with rights and hurts and emotions, just the same as they have. All too often when we start talking about these things of racism, Black Lives Matter, Aboriginal Lives Matter, all those kinds of things, we want to put them in a box and we don't think of them as equal. I saw one thing. I said, we will be able to stop. How did that go? We will stop paying attention to we will start understanding Black Lives Matter when we can stop referring back to the 300 or 400 years where Black lives didn't matter. And that's where we've set our stage, you know, where people didn't accept Black people as human. You know, they were brought over. And I'm struggling here because I haven't studied that. I have friends from everywhere, but you know, the movement is saying, look at the things, the systemic racism that's causing such ill effects to everybody. And how do we get beyond that? How do we get people to understand that we have a right to be here too? As Aboriginal people, how do we get people to understand that we have a right to occupy space in this time and this area too, as equals? And that's the tough thing to get people to understand. Sorry.
Go ahead, Susan.
Well, so I was looking at my notes. I was going to read more about Kimberly Crenshaw, but that report is coming out. I'm reviewing a draft of it. But learning is hard. Learning is hard. I'm just going to use that as my foundational piece. And it was hard for me. But my experience as Army brat growing up, I don't know if that's a correct word, grew up in a military base, Canadian citizen, got some education, became a homeless person, a person who experienced homelessness for a decade. Now I'm employed as a person who transitioned and changed their sex and gender. It gives me an incredible view of the world from a very wide perspective, with invisible disabilities. I think that's visible, depends what time of day you meet me, how visible they are, but and not to make fun of disabilities, just trying to make some humor. But and the last time I made someone laugh was yesterday at the massage clinic, a new massage, and was working on my legs, and we had a great time, and I just brought my humor to the appointment. So there's part of that. All of those experiences inform how I experience everyday events, whether the internet's working, whether the landlord's doing what we expect the landlord to do. And everybody deserves to have employment, whether you're trans or LGBT or Indigenous, person with disability, whatever your background. We all should be striving to have some income security and a decent job, a decent unionized job, if I may add that on. I'll stop there now because I'll get to some more questions, but thanks for asking.
Thanks, Susan. I think at this moment, I just wanted to like do a quick shake and just to say that all the things I'm about to say can exist at the same time. That I am Black, I am Caribbean, I am cisgendered, I am queer, I speak English. All those things are parts of me that I'm super proud of, except the English part. I'm super proud of, but at the same time, thinking of what Michael said, when I walk into a room and also thinking what Sarah said, when I walk into a room, I don't choose how systems interact with me. And I don't choose how my, like, there, I have some choice, some personal choice, but in a lot of other ways, I don't have choice. So there's systemic power and personal power. And at the same time, I can acknowledge all those things can be true, yet at the same time, I can also demand of you to not just see me as those things and to make me a sort of single story, right? And so I just wanted to say that because I wanted to bridge some of what Sarah was saying around the systemic piece is really critical. And where I think Michael was going with, you know, we are so much more than these identities, but I want us to also recognize that there's also pride in those identities and that we shouldn't shirk away from that. Because I think that's what, systemically, that's what has been taught in the Caribbean. We were told Indigenous peoples were killed. And so many of us who have Indigenous roots, like myself, we don't want to talk about that because we see it as something that's not filled with pride. So how do we sort of reoccupy these really beautiful, complex places and positions of power and identity, not in ways that limit us, but instead in ways that fuel us and give us the kinds of knowledge and fill the kinds of historic and emotional voids in our spirit to really do the work. So I just wanted to say that before we move on. Cool. All right. So we have so many questions from the audience. So I'm going to have to pick and choose. I'm so sorry. But as I said, for folks who really wanted us to answer their questions and we are unable to get to it, please send us an email. So there's a question around how can non-Black folks be supportive during this time? And the person, when they were talking about this time, they were talking about, you know, the pandemic, but also increasing, at least, it's debatable, at least increasing on the TV, more people being killed, more Black folks being killed. So how can non-Black folks be supportive in this time? So Sarah, I'm gonna give you a Black break unless you wanna jump in. And Susan and Michael, do you wanna maybe comment on that? Like, how do you see as the positions you occupy and maybe just speaking broadly to how non-Black people can be in solidarity with Black folks?
You know, that's a tough one. And I try to position myself so that I have a deeper understanding of where this is going. And, you know, when you see the stuff on the TV, which is hyper-sensationalized and whatnot, but, you know, when people are being murdered in the street for a wellness check, or for, you know, a simple traffic stop or a simple this or that. And the only reality that can explain why they're being treated that way is because of the color of their skin. How can you justify that? How can you, and our police officers down south especially seem to be doing that and then protecting each other from that. There's a group of Aboriginal police officers that police the north, and they boast, well, not boast, they have been in the newspaper or in the news saying we've been doing this for many years, 12-15 years, and not one person has died while we have gone to check in on them. Not one person has died as a result of our intervention. And you know, there's a group of four, they're not RCMP, they're wellness checkers, and they go in without firearms, and they talk to people, and they service the communities in the north, and so to try and understand how to take all of that and bring it down into what is happening in the States right now is very difficult for me to understand, because they seem to have a that undercurrent of racism that is rampant and being left unchecked. So I'm looking for people like Sarah and Susan to help me understand this. And I'm sorry that I'm struggling, but that's just where I am. And, you know, I'm trying to be honest and open here. So I'll stop there and let them.
I appreciate your honesty, Michael. Susan, did you want to jump in?
Well, yeah, learning is hard. hey, I borrowed this from that saying from Vivian Namaste about 15 years ago as a keynote speaker at the Canadian Rainbow Conference in Gatineau. But it stuck with me. Learning is hard. And I donated to Black Lives Matter Toronto. I'm not sure that is an economic framework, but I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to go in the streets. I was afraid of what about the virus? I haven't been to rallies. I think I might be going to a CUPE rally next month. But I was thinking, oh no, like it's dangerous. And I'm a little older, but I did donate, and I just about fell off my chair when I found out it was American dollars. It cost me an extra 50% Canadian dollars, but I did that. I mean, that's one way you can support. I forget the term you use, Kimberly. And, you know, I'm actually a little bit, I was going to say freaked out. So it's become more conversational now. I'm off my academic notes, but this is really hard. Learning is hard when I'm looking at Hollywood squares here. Need to get in a room with people so we can see, you know, nuances and contexts. And that really, for me, individualizes it, because we see so little of you on a little screen here on Zoom, which is how we're getting along nowadays. But the one thing I've been doing that I feel very proud of over the last couple years, and I think being with CUPE and being going to a lot of human rights meetings and being with a lot of people, so when I hear I'm at lunch with someone or I'm talking to in casual conversation, someone makes a racist comment, and I go, you know, that's a racist comment. And sometimes it goes well and sometimes it doesn't, but I try to use that as an educational moment just to show the individual who's making these negative comments, try to explain to them why that is a racist comment. And I haven't had to done that a lot since we're on Zoom, but I feel that that's one thing I've been able to help do. You know, again, learning is hard. Not everybody understands it when you call someone out, but I know as a trans person, nobody knows I'm a lesbian, but it's a secret. but like if someone, me always having to defend myself is very, very tedious. It makes me feel angry after a while. And sometimes my response is always the kindest and friendliest if it's happened a lot and I'm having a bad day. So on that, I think it's really helpful for us white people, white folks, to have those conversations, to have those difficult conversations when someone makes a derogatory comment that's racist or sexist or anti-oppression of all sorts.
Thank you, Susan. Sarah, did you want to say anything to this question, like how non-racialized folks can be in solidarity with Black folks?
Yeah, for sure, if there's time. I know it can be overwhelming to, there's so much going on. So a lot of people have been saying, you know, I don't know where to start. I think a way to start is find out what's going on in your own backyard. Like, don't worry about what's going on in the States right now. Don't worry about what's going on in Toronto unless you live there. Like, find out what's going on in your actual city. How many people have been harmed by police? Who's organizing, right? What mutual aid programs are going on right now that you can contribute to? If you have access to resources, donate. If you don't have access to monetary resources, is there anything else you can contribute? Because that's the whole premise of mutual aid, giving back what you actually are able to, whether it's labor, it doesn't have to be in person, even just in attending meetings. Half the work is showing up and just being aware of what's going on in your own community and building those relationships from the ground up. And then the last thing I want to say is, I'll say it very quickly, is some of the most disheartening experiences that I have had over my short time as an organizer here in Hamilton have been when comrades and accomplices have failed to call out ableism, racism, sexism, and issues that deeply affect me or involve me in the moment because I didn't know what to say or what to do. It's exhausting when you're worried about, you know, fighting the fight, fighting the system, creating change, worried about putting your energy on the front lines outside and then at home in your inner circle. Your own people on your team don't have the capacity in the moment or the foresight or the attention span to nip things in the butt in the moment, right? It creates this dynamic where the onus is always on the person who is, for lack of a better term, I'm blanking, but marginalized in that space to speak up all the time and to be seen as the angry one. And it feeds back into the tropes and the assumptions that the problematic people in these spaces tend to build over time, right? And so as an ally, as an accomplice, whatever you want to call it, you have to build the will, the capacity to say something in the moment, right? Even if it's your teammates, even if it's your comrades, because that's where the work is. There will always be systemic change to fight as long as capitalism lives. But if we can't figure out how to fight these battles in our own backyards, what's the point in the work?
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. Like, your comments were making me think about, like, so many times being the only Black person in a room, much less Black woman in a room, and always having to be on and present and activated to, like, call something out or notice something. Like, you can't afford to, like, doze off, take a coffee break, because you just never know what's going to go on in a meeting. And I think that speaks to the kind of fatigue and undue responsibility that falls on the backs of folks to, like, be always aware and be always on, and when really it should be a collective responsibility. So looking at the time, everyone, I think we should wrap up. So I wanted to just give all of you an opportunity to give some closing words, some closing thoughts. It could be a question that you are still sitting with that maybe you're going to leave and, like, think about. It could be an invitation to something, an invitation to act. Whatever is feeling alive for you, I just want to give you about a minute each, maybe 2 minutes each, just to kind of give closing words, and then we'll pass it over to Dawn. So maybe we'll start with you, Michael.
Yeah, I was hoping you would start with somebody else, but that's okay. I really have to thank Sarah and Susan for their words. You know, Susan says, learning is hard. As a school teacher, learning is hard. Everything's hard until you get it. And I'm still trying to get it. And some of the things that Sarah said, especially in the beginning, opened my eyes, opened my mind. And now I have to sit and think about those things because I don't have all the answers. And once I start assuming that I do have all the answers, then all those isms and negative things are going to come back in. Being who we are is exhausting. Not only because physically I'm disabled and that's a problem, that's a challenging thing, or I'm Aboriginal and I'm out there. It's exhausting defending territory all the time. And we shouldn't have to do that. We should not have to do that. We are who we are and just accept that. And why can't we do that? But the world's not there yet. The people that are around us, not there yet. So we keep doing what we do and we keep trying to move forward. That information session. I still believe that all of these isms, racism, bigotry, and whatnot is based on ignorance. And through teaching and sharing, we'll get them to understand.
Thank you, Michael. Okay. Susan. You're muted.
Find the unmute button here. There's two of them. I found a second one on Zoom up in my little box there. Learning is hard. It's like my foundational. Unlearning is harder. So I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking of all the things that I wish I would have said, but I'm thinking, like, we've already got so much time and we're sharing the space with others. And Sarah talked a lot about capitalism, and thank you for that. That really, I forget sometimes that I'm living in that type of economic system. But systems and anti-oppression, what I missed to say, creates structures of systems of advantage and systems of disadvantage. And it places people in those. I think we're here as equity seeking groups. I like to be able to say we're equity achieving groups sometime soon. But those systems cause the inequality. So those, I'm thinking of that. And I had another thought and it just kind of blew away. And I wish I had like a good closing argument, because I didn't take notes for this, but on those systems of oppression and disadvantage, it takes us working together, all of us here, with what we see in front of us on the little Hollywood square box on Zoom and or other technologies, and what we know. But it takes us, it's important to be united and to support each other in the struggle. And around anti-racism, there will be plenty of opportunities to take action, to do something, to be supportive, to call someone out when they make a negative comment, or to sign up for a campaign or sign a petition in the next few months. I'm pretty certain of that. So I want to close with saying that solidarity, and we're stronger by working together.
Thank you, Susan. And Sarah.
Sorry, I meant to turn my mic on. If the topic today is about allyship and being, and how that ties back into and how that ties back into anti-racism work, I think the number one piece of advice that I would give people is commit to discomfort, especially as people trying to become allies. Don't come into the work assuming that you know everything, assuming that it's going to be a comfortable and safe space for you as you're in this journey of trying to learn your place in this work. It's going to be uncomfortable because, like Susan said, you're going to have to do a lot of unlearning and self-work. And I think once you're able to commit to being uncomfortable in this sort of work, you'll be able to contribute as a meaningful ally in this space.
Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, I agree. Stay humble, not stay So Dawn, I'll pass it on to you now to give us closing words. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Kimalee. I'm just overwhelmed and so grateful for your time. And thank you for your honesty and your insight and your wisdom and passion. I've really learned a lot tonight in moving forward. And I love the phrase unlearn. It's like, what does that mean? But then now I get it, you know. Kimalee, thank you for being such a wonderful moderator. And to everybody that joined us tonight or sent in questions, it was wonderful. So our next webisode is going to be Tuesday the 29th. And it's going to be on long-term care. So those messages will be coming out shortly for those, for that next webisode. So thank you, everybody. And watch the feed if you can and pass it along to everyone. And it was wonderful having everyone tonight. Good night.